The stories that intrigue us most from our past are often the bloodiest and most horrific.
Names like Vlad the Impaler, Richard III, and Attila the Hun have an almost mythical status. And we remain fascinated by the dark deeds of Roman emperors and rampaging Vikings.
But it's easy to forget that these people and their victims were real.
And that the facts are usually more complicated than the bloody tale.
I'm Joe Crowley, journalist and investigator.
And I'm Dr. Susanna Lipscomb, historian and author.
Together, we're going to discover the secret stories behind history's most infamous characters and events.
Looking again at history's crime scenes.
So this is it, this is case closed.
Hunting down evidence.
Wow, so look at these. So these are the proof.
And coming to some very surprising conclusions.
Think you know history's bloodiest tales?
Time to think again.
In this episode, we're investigating three of Europe's most gruesome stories of witchcraft and magic.
What role did the infamous Spanish Inquisition play in a witchcraft outbreak involving thousands of people?
People would have been unable to do much other than pray and scream.
Were an 18th century gang of masked robbers in the Netherlands really in league with the devil?
The only confessions we have is extracted under torture.
And why were a family of gravediggers blamed for a killer disease which decimated the small town of Frankenstein?
This was a bloody, gruesome and horrific piece of theatre. November 1610. 30,000 people gather in northern Spain for the public execution of a coven of witches.
70-year-old Maria de Abarua has been found guilty of being the Queen Witch. She's accused of leading the coven in the village of Zugramudi, of killing babies and of devil worship.
For months, she and the rest of the coven have been in the hands of the dreaded Spanish Inquisition. Now six of them will be chained to stakes and burned to death.
But were Maria and the others really guilty? Or was the Inquisition working to a hidden agenda? Nestling in the Pyrenees, 360 kilometres from Madrid, lies the remote village of Zugramudi. Yet in the early 17th century, this out-of-the-way place became the target of one of history's most feared organisations, the Spanish Inquisition. In 1609, the Spanish Inquisition came to Zugramudi to investigate claims of witchcraft made by local clergy and their informants. As you can see today, the town has a whole museum dedicated to the affair, and it names those who were caught up in it, including this woman, Maria de Abarua, who was accused of being the Queen Witch. Set up in the late 15th century, the Inquisition wanted to ensure the purity of the church by controlling Jews and Muslims who'd converted to Catholicism. Local historian Adoya Mentiberi has investigated the Zugramudi witchcraft case.
So Adoya, what happened when the Inquisition arrived in town?
Well, they came in with their robes, looking scary. They arrested women, elderly people, children as young as nine. They created such atmosphere of fear and panic that the locals started accusing each other to try and save themselves, really.
At the centre of the accusations was 70-year-old Maria de Abarua. She was denounced as the Queen Witch, and more than 20 other men and women in Zugramudi were said to be members of her coven.
So what sort of things were they actually accused of doing?
Eating corpses, flying, also stealing children. The witches, when they were initiated, were given a toad. They were supposed to dress the toad, pamper it really, like as a pet. If they failed to do that, the toad would communicate with the devil.
Gosh, that's incredible, and people really genuinely believe these things.
It's pretty incredible.
But these wild stories were enough to deliver them into the Inquisition's hands.
They were thrown into these secret prisons the Inquisition had, tortured and accused of witchcraft.
Adoy has explained to me the horrifying events that took place here in the 17th century. What I want to understand is how the people of a remote mountain village got so carried away that they were willing to execute people.
The Spanish Inquisition conjures up images of fanatical priests dressed in black robes who are determined to torture and kill heretics and witches. But, of course, history is rarely that simple. I'm heading to the tourist attraction, the Amsterdam Dungeon, to get the inside story on this notorious organisation. And in the dock is Inquisition historian Thomas O'Connor. Thomas O'Connor, tell me, is this how it would have been? Three inquisitors looking down on the cowering alleged witch in the dock.
It would have been very much like this, Joe, at the time. I would have something to worry about if I were in this position before the Spanish Inquisition. The experience was indeed a terrifying one.
And how pervasive was that intimidation? Was anyone free from it?
All of us were subject to the Inquisition, and all of us had reason to fear its power.
Wow, you've got me worried now. I feel quite uneasy. I thought we were friends, but now I've got no idea what they're thinking of me. I think I'm going to come down and swap their company for yours. The Inquisition acted as a religious watchdog in Spain for 350 years, and its investigations could have a devastating impact on people's lives. What about Zugarramurdi? I mean, what's the role of the Inquisition when it comes to town there?
Well, the role of the Inquisition there is to make a bad situation much, much worse. There always had been witches or accusations of witchcraft. It's when the Inquisition intervenes that the situation gets out of control, the mass denunciations happen, and I would say a sort of hysteria seizes the whole community. However, it's very, very interesting to note that the inquisitors who were involved in this case were of divided minds.
Oh, really?
Two of them had a very, very strict view of what was going on. A third was a bit of a doubting Thomas.
The third man was Inquisitor Alonso de Salazar Frias, a highly educated lawyer.
He was interested in distinguishing between the imagination of the alleged witch and the reality of his or her life. So in the Inquisition itself, some people say, oh God, this is a pact with the devil, it's a horrible heresy, people are doomed and damned. So he was very, very anxious to distance both himself and the denounced from the hysteria, the social and personal hysteria, which seems to have seized this whole community and the inquisitors themselves at the time.
In Zugarramurdi, Salazar was the junior of the three inquisitors. But his reasoning and techniques had a profound impact. He seems to have recognised the hysteria for what it is and seen that it makes people say crazy things.
Absolutely. He was the one who introduced a scepticism and a doubt into the whole process, which became enormously significant for the future of witch trials in Spain.
Thanks to Salazar, inquisitors were encouraged to interrogate and convict on hard evidence, rather than on the imagination of an alleged witch or victim. It's fascinating to learn some of the detail about the Spanish Inquisition, but how is it then that when we look at the case of Zugarramurdi, that even though Salazar, this great modern thinker, is there, and even though witchcraft can be seen as actually quite a minor heresy, people are still burned alive for being witches?
Joe's found that the Spanish Inquisition had a tragic impact on the lives of people in Zugarramurdi. But what fascinates me is why people in villages like this were willing to believe that witches were living among them.
So what exactly is going on here? People claim that they were abducted at night by other witches and taken to the witches' coven. I need to find out a bit more. Were people just making up stories, or was there something else going on?
hoping clinical psychologist Professor Peter Kinderman can help me understand how such wild accusations start and why people were so happy to believe them.
Here in the caves is supposed to be actually where the witches gathered. It's a pretty spectacular feature, isn't it?
It's an extraordinary place, and to have this as a setting for the story that you're telling makes everything very dramatic, very powerful and immediate.
Once rumours began, they spread like wildfire.
The story is that witches are abducting people at night, taking them off into their coven to meet here in the caves. And it's really hard to understand exactly what's going on.
The place to start is that for the people at the time here, these sorts of stories about witches, about the devil, about the afterlife, were absolutely as real to them as stories today about mobile phones, air travel and nuclear weapons are for us. People were making sense of the things that happened to them in the light of their understanding of everyday life.
Fear of torture and being burnt at the stake encouraged the people of Zugurumudi to make wild accusations against each other.
I think everybody was terrified all of the time. All you need is for one accused person to confess and in their confession to implicate two other people, and you've got a geometric progression of terror.
This wasn't just a problem in Zugurumudi. Across the region, village after village began reporting the same kind of diabolical rituals taking place. This idyllic mountain setting had become a place of nightmares.
That's been thought of as a sort of mass hysteria. Do you think that's helpful in understanding this case?
I think the term mass hysteria implies that these people are crazy or ill in some way, and I don't think that's true at all. To accuse your neighbour of being a witch strikes us in modern times as being bizarre, but to phone up MI5 and say that you think there's a bomb factory in the flat next door? No, we understand that.
So we don't want to over-rationalise this. I mean, there's a huge amount of emotion involved here.
Both sides of the equation are horrific. To be possessed by the devil and to lose your immortal soul was more terrifying than anything we can imagine in the modern world. And the other side of the equation, the legal investigation, could ultimately lead to you being tortured to death in public.
Maria and the other alleged witches were in a no-win situation, with only their faith to fall back on, and the ultimate test of that was about to come.
I know from my own work that so many of the times when there are witch trials, they occurred because there was some cataclysmic event, a plague, a famine, a poor harvest, and people needed something and someone to blame. But that's not what happened here. There was no cataclysmic event. Instead, it's just a case of a community tearing itself apart because of fear and because of their deeply held beliefs.
Inquisitor Alonso de Salazar's investigation resulted in the release of many suspected witches. But Salazar could not save them all. Maria de Abarua and five others were found guilty.
Maria and her fellow so-called witches were just a few of the thousands of innocent people to be burned to death over a period of 300 years. But how did it actually work? And why was Maria killed in such a brutal way?
To help answer these questions, I'm meeting witchcraft historian Dr. Alison Rowlands.
Alison, just what lay ahead for Maria and the other so-called witches? Was there any kind of final appeal, any way they could get themselves off the hook at this late stage?
What they could have done was confess to being witches. But I think we need to think back to their mindset. For them, the afterlife and their immortal soul was very, very important. And to at least these six individuals, they would have felt it was a greater sin to make a false confession.
Once she'd refused to take the easy way out, there could only be one outcome for Maria. She and her fellow victims would die in one of the worst ways imaginable.
Why burning? Why this horrific death? Why not being hanged or having your head chopped off?
The religious thinking really is that by the body being burnt, the soul is purified. So there is a kind of a twisted logic that you're helping these people's souls in the afterlife by burning their bodies in this life. I think the inquisitors genuinely thought that telling these people that that's what's going to happen to them would have persuaded them to confess, but it doesn't. And so the Inquisition then have to go through with that punishment. Unfortunately, they would almost certainly have been able to feel, smell, and experienced the excruciating pain of the flames as they crept upwards. People just have been held upright and unable to do much other than perhaps pray and scream.
Maria and the other so-called witches died in the most appalling way imaginable. And to think they could have saved their lives if they just confessed, if they just repented their sins. But our main inquisitor, Salazar, he does mark the beginning of the end. His report to the Inquisition brought to an end witch burnings like this in Spain. And it's a tragic irony because it's his evidence that led to the Zugarramurdi witches being pardoned just 4 years after they died in the flames.
of May 1772. Josef Kirchhoffs, a wealthy and religious surgeon, climbs the gallows and prepares for a brutal death.
He's been found guilty of leading a ruthless bandit gang known as the Bokken Riders, said to be in league with the devil. They've terrorized an area of the Dutch frontier for years.
Despite months of horrific torture, Kirchhoffs faces the noose, still denying any link to the notorious gang.
So is he a criminal mastermind who's been leading a double life, or a totally innocent man?
The celebrations that you can see going on all around me are in honour of some 18th century Dutch folk heroes, the Bokken Riders. Bokken Rider means billy goat rider, and there are images of them everywhere around here. So this is what the fuss is all about. This is a Bokken Rider. Here he is on his billy goat, witch's hat on his head, carrying a firebrand, and about to ride off into a blood red sky.
Today, many people see the Bokken Riders as anti-authority heroes, a Dutch version of England's legendary Robin Hood. But contemporary accounts describe them as a violent, sacrilegious gang of robbers who often targeted priests and churches.
Matters came to a head in 1771 when local doctor Josef Kirchhoffs was arrested and accused of being the leader behind the whole thing. So which is it, Robin Hood-style heroes or devil-worshipping villains?
One significant location in the Bokken Rider story is the town of Herzogenrath. Today it's in Germany, but right next to the Dutch border. I'm here to meet François van Gehoogten, president of the society that wants to keep alive the memory of the Bokken Riders.
François, what makes this town the centre of the story?
The French area, it was about 20 kilometres from here. The German area was about 10 kilometres from here. And this was a Dutch area. The criminals could escape very fast into another country where there was another justice.
What made the Bokken Riders so different, so much more terrifying than any other normal criminal gang?
They were accused of robberies and burglaries, etc. But they had to say that they have pledged an oath to the devil.
The robberies ranged over such a wide area that the story arose that the devil had given the bandits flying demon goats to ride. The ruthless efficiency of their attacks convinced both the authorities and the terrified population that they were controlled by a single, all-powerful leader. And that man was Josef Kirchhoffs.
François, what does this church have to do with our central character, with Josef Kirchhoffs?
This is the Church of St. Mary, and he was here arrested on the 17th August of 1771.
That must have been quite shocking to be arrested as one emerges from church in front of everyone. Very humiliating.
Of course, it was about 100 yards from his house. Everyone knew him as a good man. And then suddenly he was like a criminal.
Tell me about Kirchhoffs. What do we know about him?
He was born here in 1724. He went into the army, and after 9 years, he came back to his hometown and he became here the official town surgeon of Herzogenrath. He married and had 6 children when he was arrested here at this church.
Why would they arrest him, of all people?
The belief of the prosecutors was that he was a man with two faces. He lived in the eyes of the people like a good Christian, but at night he was the leader of the gang, like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Kirchhoff's military training would certainly have been useful for a ruthless group of bandits, and he was named by more than one alleged gang member under torture.
Was it a case of him leading a double life? Was he actually the elite leader of this gang?
The story of Joseph Kirchhoffs and the Bockenriders is surrounded by myth and legend. Now, I want to try and cut through that, and I think probably the best way to do it is to look back at the official records. After all, surely you don't torture and execute a respectable man like Kirchhoffs without leaving some kind of a paper trail.
The original legal records on Kirchhoffs and the Bockenriders are held in Maastricht, in a former church now home to the Limburg Historical Archives. Archivist Truus van Rooij-Rooks has been studying this crucial evidence. And if anyone can help me get to the bottom of this case and uncover the truth, it has to be her.
When it comes to the Bockenriders, there are many tall tales. But what can we establish from the original documents? What sort of facts can we bring out?
These are the reports of the torture inflicted on people convicted as a gang member of the Gang of Thieves. Okay. They break and entry in other people's houses and churches and abbeys. The big question hanging over the Bockenriders, did they do what they were accused of having done? And the only confessions we have is extracted on the torture.
It's all a bit baffling. There are hundreds of trial documents here, but I haven't seen anything that proves Kirchhoffs was a criminal mastermind, only vague accusations clearly made under torture.
Do any of these sources tell us about Joseph Kirchhoffs, the man himself, his character?
What we know about his character is a character reference from 1752, when he was still an army surgeon. He is described as not only a skillful surgeon, but as a very respected and very Christian person.
So it does seem a bit far-fetched, this very nice guy who was very true to his principles, a sort of devout Christian, would end up being part of these brutal gangs.
Yes. People are amazed that he is arrested. He was warned about his arrest being at hand.
Oh, really?
And then he was offered sanctuary in Westphalia with his family. He said, no, I'm staying.
He was tipped off. He could have run away. He was told his arrest was imminent, yet he doesn't.
There was not one shred of physical evidence against him.
Yeah.
Only the confessions and the fact that he was denounced in torture interrogations by others.
Clearly this comes down to the torture, doesn't it?
Yes. You know,
how can I find out more about the torture he suffered?
Well, the castle where the torture took place still exists, so you can see for yourself if you
like. That should give me a pretty good idea.
Oh yes, I think it will.
Truus and I have travelled 35 kilometres to the castle at Herzogenrath to find out more about the brutal torture inflicted on the alleged Bockenriders.
Right, wow, look at this. How would these gruesome objects have been used?
They start with the thumb screws, first on one thumb, then on the other.
You said a thumb screw, I mean, this is like a hand screw, isn't it?
Yes.
Even just by pressing gently, you can feel that
it would just be absolute agony.
And if that didn't make someone talk, they screwed on the Spanish boot.
So what does it do?
This is applied behind your calf, and this to the shin, and then with this handle it's screwed on, so it crushes your shin, really. The third degree was they tied the hands behind the back, and then they hung you on a strapada.
By your hands?
By your hands, feet off the floor, so you hung by your own weight.
Is that even possible? I thought that would just break your arms, would it not?
Yes.
It would.
Your organs rupture as well. It's not just the shoulder blades, but it's your entire inside gets torn up and torn apart. In some reports, people, after 5 minutes, they say, please screw me loose, screw it loose, I'll talk, I'll confess.
Dozens of alleged gang members were tortured here, and most quickly confessed. But not Kirchhoff's. He told his judges, gentlemen, you can tear my body to pieces. I have nothing to say. But was he sticking to a code of silence, or was he genuinely innocent? Despite the lack of conclusive evidence against Kirchhoff's, judges here at Herzogenrath certainly thought he was guilty. And after months of torture, his fate was sealed.
He is condemned to death, and his death sentence is read to him out loud in this room.
Right here?
Right here, yes.
Really?
He was sentenced to hanging on account of 9 burglaries. That was the best they could come up with after these sorts of tortures. 9 burglaries over a period of 9 years.
Hardly the record of a master criminal.
And what do we know of his final moments?
Yes, they're documented, and I'll read them to you. Thus, they led Kirchhoff's outside to the Beckenberg, where the gallows was erected. At 11 a.m., the executioner put the noose around his neck. In a shaking voice, he calls out, Jesus, for thee I live, Jesus, for thee I die.
So do you believe he could have been gang leader or even just gang member?
It's highly, highly unlikely that he had anything to do with it. There's no evidence whatsoever.
Kirchhoff's wasn't the only one to die. More than 350 so-called Bakken riders, both men and women, were either hanged, broken on the wheel, or burnt to death.
Torture is central to this bloody tale. And of course, the problem with torture is that it makes historical evidence really, really unreliable, because whether you're guilty or not, with enough of these implements on you and enough pain, you will confess. So it's fascinating that Josef Kirchhoff's never does. For me, he was far more scapegoat than goat rider.
of September 1606. Wenzel Forster and his family have worked as their community's gravediggers for decades.
But today it's their turn to be visited by the Grim Reaper.
Forster, his wife, and their servants will be tortured, then burnt alive for spreading a deadly disease which has killed hundreds of people.
They're also accused of cannibalism, necrophilia, and being servants of the devil.
But did Forster and his wife really carry out these satanic crimes? Or were they victims of fear and prejudice?
Traveled to Central Europe to find out more about Forster's gruesome tale.
This is the town of Ząbkowice Śląska in southern Poland. For centuries, it's been a market town, catering to the surrounding countryside, but not the sort of place that you think would make it on the headlines. But in 1606, this remarkable illustrated news sheet was published. It's a sort of tabloid newspaper of its day, and the story it told put the town firmly on the map. But back then, Zomkowice had a different name. It was called Frankenstein.
In 1818, Mary Shelley wrote her famous horror story about scientist Victor Frankenstein, who built a monster from dead body parts. 200 years earlier, the town of Frankenstein had its own real-life horror story when hundreds of people died of the plague. The 1606 news sheet details not just the victims, but also the people held responsible. It put the blame for the deadly epidemic squarely on a family of gravediggers who worked the town graveyard. And it told an incredible story of poisoning, robbery, and black magic. Accused were head gravedigger Wenzel Forster, his wife, servants and assistants. I've come to the graveyard where they worked to meet historian Dr. Karen Lambrecht, who unearthed the story of the Frankenstein plague.
I've got this evidence of this horrible incident that happened here in Frankenstein in 1606. So exactly what is going on in this extraordinary picture?
We see here the gravediggers spreading and scattering poison, which caused the plague.
Forster was accused of smearing a paste made from corpses on door handles throughout Frankenstein to spread the disease. But the allegations against him didn't stop at poisoning.
And what's going on here?
They were accused of not only spreading poison, but ritual murder, robbery. Here you see a gravedigger eating a child.
That's cannibalism.
They abuse the dead corpses. They cut children out of the body of a pregnant woman.
Gosh, that's really graphic.
As town gravedigger, it was Forster's job to bury plague victims. His access to fresh corpses made it easier to believe he was guilty of these accusations.
What Karen has just told me is shocking and surprising. Across Europe, there were witchcraft trials, but here, the trial was against gravediggers who were accused of spreading the plague. I think I need to get an understanding of why the plague gripped the popular imagination in such a way that they were willing to persecute and kill people they thought responsible for spreading it.
I've come to London, where 60 years after the Frankenstein epidemic, 100,000 people died of the plague. I've arranged to meet medical historian Professor Robert Jutter at St. Bride's Church, the last resting place of hundreds of plague victims.
So, Robert, I'm hoping you can tell us all about the plague. Do we know how many people died in our little town of Frankenstein?
According to the records we have on that period, about 1,500 died, and this was quite a high number. Up to a quarter of the population died within 1 or 2 weeks.
So it just comes so quickly. It's very arbitrary, isn't it?
Exactly. We had the cases in the family where people got up in the morning and they were dead by the end of the night. So this is the frightful death, a sudden death, which shocked people at that time. People feel that they were not prepared for the last judgment, and therefore this sudden death was absolutely terrifying.
Churches were overwhelmed with burials during plague outbreaks. But not everyone who died would get a proper funeral.
Oh, Robert, look at this. It really brings home the human aspect of it.
Absolutely, because what people feared most at that time was not to get an individual grave and to be buried in a pit. We get an impression of how scaring it was to be buried with hundreds of people in one spot at the same time.
All stripped of their individual identity.
Absolutely. Most of the bones, as you see here, are scattered. So this really resembles a mass grave of the plague in the 17th century.
I think seeing this gives me just
some sense, just a glimmer of understanding of why people in the early 17th century in Frankenstein would have been so horrified by plague that they would have turned on people they thought had caused it.
Thanks to Mary Shelley, the name Frankenstein is world famous. But perhaps the events that took place in the town of Frankenstein really deserve the credit for creating a name that will forever be associated with horror.
Susie discovered that up to a quarter of the population of Frankenstein were wiped out by the plague. Could the gravediggers really be responsible for the outbreak by creating potions and poisons?
Is there any way of knowing exactly what these were? Obviously, the authorities at the time didn't have any kind of forensic lab where they could analyze them. Because for me, the idea that these were plague potions just seems ridiculous. It sounds like something dreamt up specifically to try and build a case against the gravediggers.
Forster's neighbors believe that instead of just burying their dead, the gravediggers were using the bodies to create plague potions.
Incredible stuff.
I'm meeting researcher Jürgen Mischke to find out more about what Forster was up to.
Jürgen, this idea that potions were being made from body parts, it sounds crazy. Where would this have come from?
Well, I have a little surprise for you. Potions and medicine out of dead people was quite common from the 16th to the 18th century.
In the early 17th century, people believed that medicine made from healthy corpses was particularly effective. Not only did it cure ailments, but the corpse's vitality would be transferred to the patient.
So what parts of the body are we talking about?
When you look at the scientific literature of this time, they talk about 24 parts of the human body that can be used as corpse medicine. Fat, skin, skull, bones.
Bones could be ground and flesh boiled to make medicine for ailments including epilepsy and headaches. So was Forster the local dealer for Frankenstein?
So where would the body parts originally come from?
You have to go to the executioner. The executioner had this exclusive right to do whatever he wanted with the dead bodies. It's the only way you get a young, healthy, dead body. For the executioner, it was a very important additional income. And maybe sometimes gravediggers tried to get some extra money as well.
And is it possible these potions could actually be helping spread disease?
It was forbidden to make any drug out of body parts from sick and elderly people because they knew it would be dangerous.
But if gravediggers were doing it, maybe there's a chance they didn't realize what had to be done to stop disease being spread.
Yes, when you buy illegally by a gravedigger, well, it could be dangerous.
I'd never realized corpse medicine was so prevalent.
Think of what it is. Corpse medicine is helping living people with dead people. Mm. Think of blood transfusions or organ transplants. We are still using it today.
Well, that's fascinating, because what I'd assumed was fabricated evidence to support quite wild allegations could actually relate to mainstream medicine of the day. Now, okay, maybe the gravediggers shouldn't officially have been making medicines and potions from corpses, but actually suddenly that in itself doesn't sound so weird now or out of place. However, if they were making these potions, clearly it would make them very easy targets for blame.
Joe's discovered that gravedigger Wenzel Forster may have had a sideline in illicit medicines made from corpses. And his actions could have helped spread the plague, even if unintentionally. But this still doesn't explain the darker side of the accusations against him and the others. Back in Poland, Karen and I are going to the dungeons under the town hall, where the gravediggers are believed to have been held prisoner. I'm hoping to find out why they were accused of robbery, cannibalism, and necrophilia.
They were accused for being the tools of the devil, telling them to scatter the poison and to destroy the population. They call the gravediggers the haunting dogs of the devil.
As gravediggers, Forster and the others were outsiders. People associated them with death. This made them an easy target for the darker allegations.
It seems so far-fetched. Why would they be likely to believe that gravediggers would do this?
They lived in an atmosphere of fear, and they were anxious, and the local authority had to do something.
Along with Forster and his wife, another six people were arrested and accused of spreading the plague. And with the community convinced of their guilt, they had almost no chance of defending themselves. Frankenstein wanted them dead.
The authorities were determined to force the gravediggers to confess and implicate other family members. The agonies inflicted on them soon produced the evidence required.
The journey to the final place of execution started here in the dungeons below Town Hall, where Forster and the others were imprisoned and tortured. They were then brought out and placed on a cart, which was dragged through the streets of the town so the whole population could witness their punishment and really see as a warning what happened to the guilty. After all, this was a spectacle, a bloody, gruesome and horrific piece of theatre played out on a very public stage.
Everyone in Frankenstein had a stake in the execution. They believed that with Forster and the others dead, the ravages of the plague would come to an end.
This is the old town limits. You can see where the moat once was. And as Forster and the others were brought past this place, they were already covered in terrible wounds.
This was not just physical punishment, but ritual degradation. To locals, Forster had not only poisoned their neighbors, but betrayed his oath to serve the community.
In agony from their wounds, finally Forster and the others arrived here, outside of the town, on Gallows Hill. How, at that moment, they must have longed for a swift end to their suffering. But it wasn't to be. Forster and his assistant both had their right hands cut off.
The hands were nailed to the stakes where they would die. And for the crime of necrophilia, Forster's assistant was then castrated.
Next, being burnt alive.
Forster and three other gravediggers were chained to a stake, and fires were lit around them, so they roasted to death. Over the next year, 11 more members of gravedigger families were arrested, tried, and executed. A boy of just 14 was beheaded.
This story is really all about fear. Fear in these situations makes men do unspeakable things. And the gravediggers were the scapegoats. Maybe they did create potions out of the corpses. Maybe they did unwittingly help spread this disease. But these folk remedies weren't unusual at the time. They were a type of medicine. People relied on them. And so it's with a kind of barbaric hypocrisy that people here turn on the Frankenstein gravediggers and make them pay the ultimate and very grisly price. A